Recording in
Isabel, just checking, you are the technical boss. Are we ready to go?
Yeah, just 1 minute. I'm just looking for cuts. I don't
know. Okay.
Ah, okay, she's here. Perfect. Yeah, we can start. The floor okay. is yours, baby. Thank you.
All right. Thank you very much. Good morning, everyone. I want to welcome you to, each and every one of you to the BEDA Design Forum 2021. I am Päivi Tahkokallio, the current president of BEDA, and it's my pleasure to wish you all a very inspiring day. With us today, we will have three sessions today. The first one related to mainly BEDA members sharing experiences, great experiences related to design policy and practices. And the second session will be having a focus on a dialogue between us and the Commission, the new European Bauhaus team, and experts from DG Regio. And we will be talking about design's role in transformation, especially in relation to local level regions, local administrations. And the last session, the third one later in this today, will be bringing the discussion on an international level. So stay with us, and the Zoom link you have been shared is valid through all the sessions. Also remember, we have invited experts to be with us through the day. But also every one of you, every single one in the audience, you are an expert equally. So what we are looking for is inspiring, active interaction and dialogue. And I hope you all will take part in the discussions. Now, it's my pleasure to from my heart, thank Citédu Design, one of our great BEDA member organizations. And if times were different, we would have met in Saint-Étienne, hosted by Citédu Design. Now the hosting happens online, which we all have, of course, got used to during the past year or so. But I want to introduce Isabelle. Isabelle Verriac is the Vice President of BEDA still for 2 days, then we will switch and she will become the president. Isabel will soon get the floor and to start with the session one, moderating this. We will take the moderation in turns through the day, and at a later point we will co-moderate. So again, once more, welcome to BEDA Forum, Design Forum 2021, and be active. The voice is yours as much as it's ours, and we depend on your insight and input through the day. Thank you very much. And Isabel, the floor is yours.
Thank you, Päivi, and welcome everybody. I'm so happy to have you here for today. We are not really in Saint-Étienne because of the health situation, but it seems the same for us, and I hope for you that you will have some input from Saint-Étienne also with maybe the virtual visit that some of you have registered. This morning, the first part will be to share some great experience between BEDA members, but also between BEDA partners. So we are very happy to share with all of you this experience. And this project will also focus on the three terms of the new European Bauhaus. So we have asked each speakers to choose some project showing how it's important to be inclusive, to be aesthetic, and to be sustainable in all of what we are doing today for the person and for the planet. We will have so 7 speakers. You could ask some question on the chat during the presentation. After the two first presentation, we could pick up 1 or 2 questions. And if you don't have time for sure to discuss all the things, we have planned around the room, a special room for discussion, which will be open during the lunch and after the session today. So just to remind that this session is recorded and that we will use the presentation to illustrate the best practice in our website, and that we are also direct on YouTube on the Citédu Design channel. So first I will let the floor to Kat. Kat Drew. We from the Design Council. Kat, you will explain us the systemic design framework. And also I have to say that for this session, Annette Takou-Yanko will help me to follow the question in the chat. So thank you to Anna, who is also in the room. Kat, if you would like, you could share your screen now.
Yeah, I will stop sharing yours then.
Mm-hmm.
Fine.
Okay, perfect. If you could put it in full screen.
Yeah. Great. Well, it's such a pleasure to be here with European friends. I'm feeling the kind of the warmth in the virtual room. So my name's Kat, and I'm the Chief Design Officer at the Design Council in the UK. And it's a real, real pleasure to be here on what is a very sunny morning in West London. So I'm going to tell you about the systemic design framework that we published a couple of weeks ago. And before I get into what it is, I just wanted to start by saying why we did this. And the reason why is because in our practice, we are seeing design being asked to tackle even bigger challenges, challenges like the climate crisis, like the social inequality and injustice that has been exposed through the pandemic. And in the UK, we've seen communities being flooded. We've seen people who are providing frontline work, like bus drivers, being the worst hit by the pandemic. So all of these reasons means that design has to rise up to this challenge, and that's exactly what the Bauhaus is trying to do. So that's a bit of the reason why. And then how we did it, we work within our programs where we're working with big infrastructure clients like the railways, with local authorities to support them to use design to tackle the climate crisis. And we also did interviews with 20 designers from across all design practice, from fashion to product to architecture, to ask them how were they designing for net zero. And what we created was a report which has got a number of different barriers, some case studies about their inspiring work, a set of resources, technical resources for net zero, but also a kind of overarching simple framework that lots of designers and non-designers can use together to guide their process. So it is quite high level, it's not very technical, but hopefully it can do that bridging and translation work that design does so well. So I'll just talk you through it. So it really forms around four characteristics, six principles, and a process. And the characteristics are things that we heard from all of our designers that they were doing. So some of them had all of these attributes, some of them had pockets and brought together different people into a team, but these are all really important. So a systems thinker, someone who can think big, see the connections between elements, and zoom between micro and macro. The leader and storyteller, because this sort of change is really hard and you need someone who can paint that compelling and hopeful vision of the future that others want to follow. The designer and maker, of course, this can be really complex and overwhelming. Where on earth do you start? Designers start by making something, starting small and seeing what kind of emerges from it. And then also connectors, really important. Someone who's just there focusing on the relationships and the design of how the system comes together. And six principles are also really important. And these are a kind of evolution of what we know from before. So being not just people-centered, but planet-centered, always inclusive and welcoming difference, the ability to zoom in and out, collaborating and connecting, testing and growing ideas, and also being circular and regenerative, not just in the way that we use materials, physical materials, but also social assets. And then the process. So you'll notice at the heart, we've kept the double diamond because it's something that we know is recognized. And really importantly, it helps designers talk to clients about challenging the brief, really going back to the beginning and understanding what's really needed. But you can see around it, the invisible activity that often gets lost within design and design processes and design commissioning is almost as important. So starting off with orientation and vision setting, that hopeful values piece, but also building connections and relationships, the leadership and storytelling, and then recognizing that actually things don't neatly come into a point at the end, but actually it's a much more expansive, continuous journey that we need to go on together. So starting with divergent and convergent thinking, as I said, building all these bigger elements around it, zooming in and out, we've kind of created these visuals that you might want to use with your teams. Disrupting and remaking, really important, getting to the root cause and finding that leverage point that you can make something that disrupts and allows the idea or the logic behind it to spread. And then finally, seeing this as one part of a much bigger, longer, collaborative and continuous journey. So I'd like to think that all the interventions of the 43 of us in this virtual room can come together to create something bigger. So thank you.
Thank you, Kat. Very interesting. And I see that now we are 50 people hearing you for this presentation. So hello to all the people who are just coming. Do we have any question in the chat? Anna, I saw you. Do you want to take the floor?
Yes, until now we have no questions in the chat. So take the opportunity. Yes. I keep an eye on it.
Ivy, I saw your hand.
Yeah, I didn't have time to comment in the chat yet, so I apologize for that. But if I may ask a question from chat, this is partly comment, partly question. Kat, I would very much welcome you to take part in the discussion in session two as well, because obviously what you have described, the systemic framework for design, is very much related to the discussion we are going to have in session two on how design can best serve transformation, and especially in local levels. So if you can already sort of tune yourself into that discussion, I would very much appreciate it. But my question is also related to, you know, Leila Ajarulu from New York, who is talking about a disruptive design process, which is also very much related to systemic change and design. And she is talking about, in a very simple manner, and I think very, very good manner, of three phases that we need to be able to cover in systemic design processes, which is first landscaping, understanding the big picture. And once you only once you understand the big picture, you start mining, you start focusing and getting deeper into the challenge. And then only on the third phase, you can start really doing the design, the traditional design work, to if I may put it like that. So what do you think of this approach versus the framework you have created?
So I think that, I mean, they're very, very complementary. I mean, understanding the kind of the bigger picture and the context is really what you would do in exploration and kind of discovery phase. And I suppose it's understanding that bigger picture and not just what our kind of users want, which I think has been something that has really come to the fore in the last 20 years, particularly in an amazing way. It's not to forget that bigger landscape. I love that word. One thing I would say is, I think as designers, we can actually use making to help expose that bigger landscape. So we don't always have to wait to make something until the kind of the second phase. I think some of the stuff that we do as designers is put something into the world, see how people react, and from that, it kind of reveals the wider system around it. Well, I'm really interested to hear, if you could share her work, that'd be amazing. And just as a quick heads up to everyone else, so we've published the framework and I've just put it in the chat. That's the kind of simplified version. We've got another paper coming out where we've been interviewing 40 really quite cutting edge designers about how to do deliberate systems change. And that's going to come out shortly. So more on that.
Thank you so much, Kat.
Now we have actually questions. Do we post them now to Kat?
I would like to go through. Sorry.
Make it to the second, after the second one. Okay.
Sorry, maybe after. Is it okay when I speak? Maybe we could come this, keep discussion for the end. Because time is going so fast, now we will go to the second presentation with Regina Hanke.
And we have the question for the one room. So Regina, from Deutscher Designtag, you will speak more about one of the
My turn. Sorry, I didn't hear you. Okay. Can you hear me? Yes? Great. Okay. First of all, thank you for having us and me. I'm representing today the Deutsche Designtag, and it's only has been founded in 2016 and is a highly committed volunteer organization with over 15 member organizations to bundle the voice of of design towards politics, society, and economics. So we are pretty young. Nevertheless, as umbrella organizations for all creative industries, from fine arts to architecture, via club commission to theater and social cultural education, being part of the Deutsche Kulturrat is already the Deutsche Designtag positively influencing through its participatory structure and political decision processes in reference to social design, economics, and barrier-free language and inclusion design. So it's pretty, what we are doing is more or less really influencing and lobbying for design and design industries in Germany and present and representing a united voice towards politics. So giving this in content as context, it's very interesting that you have to do to reach something, you have to use the most accessible powers which are on the market, and that's public procurement. This is a real market power for sustainability and aesthetics. I don't know if you have it on your screens or if you know that in 2014, there has been a new legislation coming to tenders and public procurements, which is Article 67, which actually went away from a macro-societal, macro-economic approach towards a very, very hands-on approach where social, environmental aspects, innovation characteristic, design for all users had to be included into tenders and public procurement. Yet, it's one thing to have a regulation, it's another thing to get it on the market and to get it running. And so what the Deutsche Designtag developed was a hands-on guideline, not only for public procurement, for people who write public procurements, but also for those people like us, like designers, how we can get into public procurement processes. So that plays a key role and it was really successful. Another thing which has to do with inclusion very much is that when we talk about inclusion and we ask others to be more inclusive, we have to start in our own sector, we believe. And design awards are extremely powerful instruments and where designers can directly, whereas we as designers can directly influence how the frame is set. So we define the rules and create according playbooks how this has to be happen. So what we started is a research into how actually juries of design awards are set, because it's not only about a design award, it's about how the design, how is the mindset behind the design award. So only if we look at our own sector, we believe this really deeply. As we look in other sectors, we can set the ground for a more powerful and more inclusive society. And the third project is, or the next project is something where we come from the bigger view to something very, very local, to become a more, to get a social change and sustainability triggered, we need to get on a local ground. So what we have to achieve is a dissemination into local areas, into our own environment. And this, for example, is a very small conference in Würzburg, which is a region in Germany, where some highly committed people set out to influence their own area, because their people talk together as on an eye level. And last, but and next one is the new education circle, which is a project by heart of the Deutsche Designtag, where we see that social change needs design and education needs professional creativity. And if we sit back and look at this, at least from a German perspective into Germany, we don't know how it was handled in other areas. The pandemic has made one thing absolutely clear. The education system in Germany is under pressure, and it is in the most other areas in Europe, and it urgently needs some renewal aspects. And this is no difference to universities or upskilling adults. Education is a crucial part if we want to achieve social change and if we want to achieve sustainability. To achieve this, we believe that design skills are actually in need, not as a blueprint or as a panacea, but as a spark for new thinking. And with this project, we target to spark new thinking in the educational areas. And this is a pan-European activity from the Deutsche Designtag. And last but not least, that the Deutsche Designtag actually developed together with BEDA, thanks for the chance for this, a joint statement for HERA. I don't know if anybody of you is familiar with HERA. HERA is the European Health Emergency Preparedness and Response Authority, which is going to come into being in the next year, approximately. And we believe design has to be a crucial part of health and public health activities, because there's a strong link between between, for example, antibiotic resistance to vaccine hesitancy or the food chain in the context of the One Health concept. When we talk about health, if we talk about human behavior, and this human behavior influence on the one side the cause of problems, like for example through pollution of our environment, and on the other hand, it can provide a solution to all these problems by changing the behavior. So that was about it, and thank you, and I'm looking forward to your questions.
Thank you so much, Regina. It's very interesting, and I think we have also some questions, but I would suggest you to go through next presentation if you wish, in order to group the question, not to be on time.
Isabel, yes? Just a quick question. There's a note in the chat that there's a bit annoying square with colors showing in the screen. Could that be deleted? I don't know who where that comes from, but could it be deleted?
I think it's come from a Regina screen, no?
Okay,
it might be, just no.
Okay.
Could you stop sharing all the screen? I think now it's okay. Yes, perfect. Thank you, Regina.
Okay.
And just keep, Anna, take the question in your mind, and we will go through the presentation of Ingrid van der Wacht from Dutch Design Foundation. You will present us a program called the Open Coalition for New European Bauhaus. So Ingrid, the floor is yours, and we come back after with the question. Thank you.
Hello there. Good morning. Oh, this is going quick. This was not the idea, so we're going to go back. Good morning, everyone. I'm really happy to have you all here. At the screen, I was looking for nice slides because I understood that I really needed to make a really nice picture presentation, maybe. And it's not so easy because I'm going to present to you something really brand new, you might say, which is the Open Coalition. I start this presentation with this slide of a little park in Eindhoven where this design, art, tech, poetry, lighting, safety, and interaction with the audience for the public space comes together. So I think it's a very representative slide for what we need these days with the sanitary crisis still going on, but things are going better. I'm really happy about that. And I thought it's nice to bring this example of a result of a what if lab, which is one of the good practices of Dutch Design Foundation. I work for Dutch Design Foundation, so we are the organizer of, amongst others, Dutch Design Week. And I stand in for the famous Bart Ahsmann, former president of BEDA, who would have been presenting otherwise the Open Coalition, as he is a kind of, could say, heading also the creative cultural industries in the Netherlands with CLICKNL. So I'm going to briefly just tell you what we just have launched last week. And it was a very soft launch, meaning that we have, well, we are contacting right now people in our network of creative cultural industries to join an open coalition, which has been also really instigated, you might say, by the call of Ursula von der Leyen, the president of the European Commission. We all know everything about it, and we will hear more about it during this morning. Because New European Bauhaus was for us really like the sign that we are all working as four partners, four initiators, on connecting creative cultural industries to the societal challenges of today, and to bring new relationships, new bridges, And we use all kinds of formats and tools and approaches to do so. I was just answering in the chat to Kat, who, thank you very much for this also very clear presentation. I'm going to dive into it later. But I thought it would have been really nice to have Bart Ahsmann here, who could explain more about the key enabling methodologies, as he calls it, which are all about also systemic interventions, but really to address these hyper complex problems of these days. And we are all facing it in our countries, but we need to approach it on a European scale. So I think that it's important that we start sharing our approaches, and we start sharing also connecting our networks and to see how we can together address the challenges that are really, well, across all borders, you might say. So Kowaiki, you see, is the center of expertise for creative innovation. Makes part of the school of university, I must say, of applied sciences in Amsterdam. But there are other partners, art schools from Amsterdam connected to it. They will have an event tonight where you can hear more about new European Bauhaus and the approach that we are taking. And Bart Ahsmann will speak there as well. I'll give you later the link. CLICKNL, we know probably the majority of you. It's of course the center of expertise. It's the center also that connects the research part and the industry part to really also advise our ministries about what is needed for the creative cultural industries in the Netherlands. And Federatie Creatieve Industrie is the top sector, you could say, for creative cultural industries and working on the vertical projects, you might say, between the different Dutch top sectors, which is water, food and health, and well, many other things. And then we have Dutch Design Foundation. And I thought you see to the right, it's a very simple presentation taken from kind of really overview we have made of good practices from our own organizations and that we want to have added on by other Dutch creative cultural institutions and also studios. So it's about practitioners and institutions to get together in this kind of really lightweight network to really join practices and also start the exchange of what do we need to work on in the Netherlands, but also what do we want to work on internationally and how can we unite ourselves in this big open coalition we hope to come for the, that is really in the making, you might say. So I just told you about this little project, which is a nice example of how we are connecting high-tech institutions to smaller design studios and bring really projects alive. And I just took also this nice picture of the What If Lab that we did with the Dutch National Railways and their partners, which is all about stations for the future, circular stations. So this is the natural station. Well, I must say, I don't think that in Holland anywhere there's a place where you could look that far away, but it's the kind of impression of what we would like to work on and want to work to. And this is also just a very brief, small invitation, a little intimate, so I think for all of you, but I do hope that during Dutch Design Week, where we will address the creator number, where we want to address topics like degrowth, topics like how can we really make buildings that are absorbing, so reducing CO2, that will be all on our agenda coming Dutch Design Week. And we do hope that the Open Coalition will have grown in meantime, and I will have more concrete projects to present to you than this really small intermezzo I want to bring to you right now. So I'm available for all questions on the different projects also we're working on, and I'll give you the link to the to the coalition document so people can read a bit back and just ask me. Okay, I'm gonna close this down.
Thank you so much, Ingrid. This is a very good illustration of coalition and cooperation. It's why we are doing with the BEDA members and the BEDA partners. So thank you so much. I saw, Anna, a lot of comment in the chat. So we could take some minutes to look at this. So if you would like to take the floor, Anna or Paivy, also if you have any comments for these three first speakers that we have before going further.
Yes, there are a lot of questions now. If you like, we could move back to Kat first. We had a question from Anna Kocki, designer, and I cannot see her at the moment, if she would like to pose her question, or I can just I can just say it for you. This she was asking about the next steps and possible goals for systemic design, also in relation to Europe or at local level. So what is your view connected to that?
So I think as a framework, it's really interesting. I was just talking to government officials in the UK yesterday, and they were saying that systems thinking is really kind of taking hold at the political level. And I can see there's a question about politics as well. So I think it's a language that is starting to have real resonance in a way that 4 years ago, it was still quite jargony and people didn't understand what it was. So I think it's kind of got this common parlance, and I would love to see local government in particular and kind of regional government, public bodies use it as a kind of method, because I think it brings together that kind of thing that public servants do so well, which is look at the kind of the bigger picture, but also what designers do really well, which is actually make something happen. So within the UK, we run something called Design in the Public Sector, where we've worked with 100 councils over the last 7 years. To upskill them with design, and that's we're using now this kind of framework. We're also working at the moment with the Greater London Authority, so the Mayor of London, on a programme called Designing London's Recovery, where we're bringing together missions of cross-sector kind of teams, and again we'll use that framework. So, and I'd love to hear how it might be used across Europe as well.
Just a technical point, if you are participant are not yet in the screen, and if you want to ask yourself the question when Anna is looking at the question, raise your hand and Sonia could switch you and you could join us on the screen and to continue the discussion with us. So feel free to raise your hand. Anna?
Cool, thank you. Regina was also commenting on Kat's presentation on the intuitive experts as designers and their possible roles. So Regina, if you feel like taking that or?
Open your microphone.
Yes, I opened, sorry. Okay, yes, I found it really interesting, the systemic approach CAT actually put forward. And in Germany, they're running several research projects who are handling similar approaches in the public health sector. And as public health is extremely complex and the issues around are extremely complex, it helps to have a systematic view on it. And we find this, or at least, it was very well received and it had a great feedback also in the politics and in the health environment in Germany. That's it.
Thank you. One last question. And after Anna, if you have in the chat, and after I propose that we go through the next speakers. Because time is going so fast.
Yes, just a moment. There is a question from Dominique Schiamma. So Dominique, if you want to pose your question, just raise your hand. That's, yeah.
Okay, so you could open your.
Yeah, okay, do you hear okay. me? Can you hear me? Yes. Mm-hmm. Okay, so thank you very much for all the presentation, very inspiring, and I think also very reassuring because we are thinking the same way, so and that's a good news. I have a question, you know. Actually, this is the question I asked also last year during the World Design Organization General Assembly. Designer experts, okay, design experts, we are always and righteously talking about ethics, responsibility, sustainability, social innovation, human-centric, planet-centric, everything, okay? But there is a word we never pronounce, okay? And I think this word is embedding all of those issues, is the P word, what I call the P word, which is politics. And we never speak about politics. We speak about, you know, everything around politics. But design is just not a practice, not only a method, not only a culture. It's a project. It's a global project. And the project is, how do we live together? How do we reinvent the way we are living together? And I think the pandemic is an accelerator of that. So why don't we say it loud and clear? Design is politics.
Yes, good question.
Can I just, I simply have to ask Dominique to continue. Can you be explicit in when you say that that design is not involved in politics? I disagree, but I would need to know more what you mean by design is not part of politics.
I say design is politics.
Yeah, but what do you mean when you say that we don't use the word? Or tell us what would be the next action points? What would need to happen next?
Well, should happen is that we are using the word, okay? Let's say it, we are doing politics, okay? Because everything that we all the presentation that we had is about that. No, really. So, and we know that we are doing politics, and we know that part of the solution is in our hands. So why don't we say it, okay? Why don't we say it by using the word itself, okay? So yes, design is politics, so why don't we say it, okay? Just this, okay? Because when we look at the situation, all the decision makers, they are not coming from design schools, okay? They are coming from engineering school, management schools, political schools, but not design schools. Look at a board. Look at the French the French cabinet of ministers. There are no designers, okay? And I think we should say, okay, we are able to train the people who will be part of the decision making, and those guys and those women will be designers.
Thank you, okay, Dominique. I could not agree with you more. We will need to continue this discussion at another time, but definitely need to.
So we will continue in the rounder room during the lunch. And now I will let the floor to Aisling Clancy from the Design and Craft Council from Ireland, and also to Kim Mackenzie, who is the founder of the project The Big Idea. So Aisling, the floor is yours if you want to share your screen.
Grace Kim is going to share a screen now in a moment. Thanks, Isabel. Morning, everyone. I'm Aisling Clancy. I'm the Education Manager of the Design and Crafts Council in Ireland. And I'm just going to give a little bit of context before handing over to Kim Mackenzie-Doyle. So in Ireland, there's an expert group on future skills needs who advise the Irish government on skills needs and labour market issues that impact on enterprise and employment growth. And they published a report, Together for Design, in 2020. And the Design and Crafts Council Ireland and the Institute of Designers in Ireland are part of a multi-department and agency group who are working together to implement the recommendations of the Together for Design report. We were asked to lead on a recommendation that the design community should explore the development of a transition year design program to promote the uptake of design as a career in schools. So we wanted to create an inclusive and sustainable program engaging with students regardless of their career ambitions. A project that worked with real world programs our projects that everyone could connect with. And we realized that the big idea was doing all of that and more. So the Design and Crafts Council Ireland and the Institute of Designers Ireland are proud supporters of this programme. And I'm going to hand over to Kim, who's going to give you an overview of the Big Idea programme now.
Thank you, Aisling. I'm just going to share my screen now. I hope you can see that. Can you see that full screen? Super. Okay. So in Ireland, we currently teach our students in silos or subjects with an emphasis on rote learning, when the true benefit in learning is divergent or transversal thinking. And that's creative thinking. Creative thinking connects and leaves room for discovery. That's not me growling, by the way, it's the dog. That's been reflected in recent studies from the World Economic Forum, LinkedIn and Forbes, and more, stating that creativity is the number one skill future employees need in 2025. And it is the skill industry and society need. And it is a skill that can be taught. The Big Idea is an innovative, nationally focused, free, creative power transition year awarding programme that was launched in January 2021. Transition year is a one-year term taken after junior cycle for students aged 15 to 16 before the two-year senior cycle. Our programme aligns schools in Ireland with top industry experts to undertake 15-week design projects in the disciplines of spaces and places, product, UX, UI, wearables, and visual communication. We provide a platform that collaboratively embeds creative skills, empowering students through inquiry-based learning, developing critical thinking through socially conscious, experience-centered projects that will connect them with their peers, industry, their community, and their world. We bridge the gap between industry and education. Our 50-50 gender-balanced, diverse mentors advise and share cutting-edge methodologies with our students, who in turn use the shared knowledge directly on their chosen project. Each week, we interview an industry leader on a creative tool they use. For example, we interview Lorna Ross, Chief Innovation Officer at VHI, on Wicked Problems. Students are supported to use creative thinking on co-creative briefs to tackle societal issues such as homelessness, racism, pandemics, aging population, and health and well-being. We are fully inclusive, providing all learning and activity materials free to schools and students. For example, a Lego pack for systems thinking exercises, sketchbook to capture brainstorming and reflection, and much more. Students create, experiment, invent, take risks, make mistakes, and have fun. But they were not the only ones to have fun. So let's hear from some of the teachers involved this year.
I loved it. I definitely want to do it again. It was so much fun. The creativity warm-ups were probably my favourite part.
They've learned how to go through a process of designing from step one all the way through. They've followed that design process, the journey that they've travelled all along the way. That's the most important thing. I mean, that's really where the learning has been.
I would personally love to do it again now that I know what's involved, because I think even I learned a lot. It's a great opportunity for any school to be a part of.
I think it was unbelievable, the level of resources and lesson plans that were given with the program. I think the support, and of course, you know, the students love getting goodies, you know, and these are so well thought out and so effective.
I absolutely love being part of the Big Idea, as did the students.
It is a great opportunity for them to think outside the box or forget the rules. The buy-in from the students and the fact that they've enjoyed it.
Seeing them being able to adapt it and come up with these ideas and think outside the box and just think of their heroes in the local community and try and come up with an initiative to help them is just fantastic.
We left a big impact on our students, 100% learning new skills through our program. 98.5% feel more confident using creative thinking on challenges that they might encounter. We have empowered students with in-demand skills, and we are going further. 137 schools across Ireland have signed up for our 2022 waiting list that is now closed, with just over 10,000 students. Not only do we have a waiting list of students, we have a waiting list of mentors. And this shows a real need and desire for this programme. And here is your invitation to experience our virtual student exhibition. All student work is on display online, showcasing their learning journey, their proposed solution, and the potential for creative thinking to the wider community. Thank you for your time.
Thank you so much. Thank you to Hasling and thank you, Kim. What I suggest you, I saw a lot of hand raised, but I suggest you to continue with another project linked also to the students and the schools. And I have the pleasure to introduce you, Jérémie Nuel, who is a teacher in our school at ESADSE, École Supérieure d'Art et de Design, our School of Art and Design at Cité du Design. He will present you a project called Design Tool for Creative Cooperation. Jérémie, the floor is yours.
Hello, everybody. I just share my screen. So I will present you, as Isabel said, a project that we will start soon. It's called Digital Tools for Creative Collaboration. And we will work with two schools, European schools, for 2 years Erasmus project. And the free school is our school. And we will lead the project. The school ECA from Tallinn in Estonia, and HFG from Swedish Mund in Germany. So the project will involve students, teachers, technicians, members of administrative staff, and we want to equip students and teachers and everybody with skills about software and computer stuff for to work together, actually. Because we know that it's a subject that we don't want to see. It's a very big subject, but last year we saw that it was very important. So we will start with we will do 3 intensive international workshops and events to highlight the project's results and also to communicate about our project. And our goals we want to make some publication and an exhibition that will traveling across Europe and build a network of schools and institutions that will work, I hope, a few years about this kind of subject. And share a culture also about software usage and digital practice in art and design, especially, for example, open source and free software that we use a lot here, and some schools that we know work also with this kind of tools. And we thought about BEDA as a partner, so because we need to do some exploratory research to start the project, we need to exchange with designers. We need to spread also this kind of subject and information across Europe. So that was at first a big, very important subject that we wanted to put. Thank you very much.
Thank you. We can't speak in the same time because we are in the same room. Thank you, Jérémie, for this presentation. And as you have seen, BEDA is an associated partner of this program. So if you have any question, the goal. Oh, sorry, it didn't work. I will let the floor to Anna. If you have any question on these two projects, but what I would like to say about this project, Design Tools of Creative cooperation is that BEDA is associated partner in order to create the link between the professional, the designers and the school and the research. So we hope that you will enjoy to join this research. We could talk more about this in the Wonder Room. So I speak a lot of this Wonder Room. So just to remind for people coming now, we will send the link, or you have already it, the link of this Wonder Room. This is another part room during the lunch and after the forum where you could continue to discuss and to create, we hope, collaboration. And just before the lunch break at 12:30, we will show you a short demonstration for this Wonder Room. So Anna, we could before going for the last speakers, we have still two other speakers. We could pick up some question or discussion.
Yes, there came, well, also the discussion on design and politics continued, and there came some direct questions to the Big Idea project, also from Maria Siavo, and also from Anna Koki. So please feel free to raise your hands and pose your questions dedicated to the Big Idea.
If not, you could read the
question. If not, then one question was that
Anna is coming. I see Anna.
Okay. They're a bit related, so I just read the other question, that kids use the sketchbooks and other tools with their own teachers independently as part of their own curriculum or as part of the program. So that was one question, and now.
So, the teachers are from any background, and actually a religion teacher taught the winning project this year, which was just amazing. So we encourage teachers from all disciplines to facilitate the program. We provide two classes per week over 15 weeks, and the teacher guides the students. We have activities for all of the materials, so the students are with any abilities are taking part and using the materials after the lessons. So we've designed the program materials to suit kinesthetic learners, listening and writing learners, absolutely everything. So we are engaging the disengaged through the program, and we have really had some incredible stories from students who have never taken part in team projects, and they're actually leading the projects. So we really hope to disseminate more findings as the weeks progress, because we've literally just finished last week.
Thank you. Anna Koki, I think that now it's okay. You could open your microphone and your video if you want to speak.
Thank you. Can everyone see?
No, wait, Jannicke, we have still one question. Yeah. Please, okay, if you just wait 1 minute, we have time. We could pick up another question before you turn. Thank you, Jannicke. Anna Koki?
Yeah, Anna, normally you can speak now.
Okay, thank you. I was interested to hear about the Big Idea program more, as I'm myself a Aalto University Creative Sustainability alumni, and we also study these same themes and try to tackle this silo thinking and work in teams. And but I would want to hear how you prepare your students to the afterlife of student life, as sometimes as a creative you may hear that you are too brave, or your ideas are too big, or whatever these kind of comments, which I find interesting, as that's what we need at the moment. So if you have anything on that, it would be great to hear.
Absolutely. And I think a big part of this is promoting confidence in students' own abilities to tackle big challenges. And the creative process can do just that because it allows grounded thinking to prove that what they are doing and what they're thinking is actually really valid and has huge potential to actually impact directly, not only themselves, but their communities and the wider thinking. So I think that not only the students have learned a lot through the program, but the teachers have. And as we, I think we all know, the students teach parents and teach wider communities. So the impact is exponential. So I really truly believe that the big idea is a great step forward in Ireland to yes, instill divergent thinking and prove the value of that, but also disseminate the understanding of the value of just creativity, pure creativity applied in every sector. So that's why we really promote that any teacher from any background. So we've had guidance counselors facilitate the program, maths teachers, STEM teachers, religion, home economics teachers, because it's valuable everywhere. And I think we have to approach this really, really broadly. So hopefully, you know, some students will become politics and understand the value of creativity. They will become teachers, they will become leaders, and they will become everything you can imagine. And that power of creativity will add value to them in a very specific and a unique way. Thanks, Anna.
Thank you.
Ivy, I see your hand raised.
Thank you. I have a very direct question, and the answer is yes or no, not maybe, to Kim. With Big Idea, are you ready to go European?
No. we have
okay, tested. Wrong answer.
Yeah, I know, but we have just tested with 500 students. And we do want to make some changes. It is evolving. We do have European ambitions. So give us another 12 months and we will be there, Pavi.
Okay, great. This is good to hear. The reason I'm asking is that actually Anna, who just spoke, and Mari, I see her commenting in the chat as well. They have been doing quite interesting work in Finland. They were too modest to say anything about that, but it's related to high school students and design education. And we have already initiated actually a discussion with the new European Bauhaus team, because they have a need in relation to the new European Bauhaus initiative. There's a need to ensure that the voice of young people is heard in the context as well. And to my mind, Big Idea is doing exactly that in Ireland. And it's also something which could be scaled up. So what I'm proposing to you, Kim, and to everyone who is here or everyone who knows of similar, not the same, but similar processes in other countries, to come back to me. Please let me know, because I would be very happy to organize a meeting with the new European Bauhaus team with everyone who is interested in scaling up. Because the challenge for the Commission at the moment is also that they hear of these solutions on local level, but for the Bauhaus initiative, we need to scale that up in Europe. So we are trying to help, and anyone who is interested, please let me know, and you will be happy to be included in the discussion directly with the Bauhaus team.
Thanks, Pavi. We'll certainly be very interested to discuss that.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Pavi, and we will happy to join also. So, Hannah, we could... It's 5 minutes after 10. If we have still one question, we could go through another question. If not, we have two other speakers waiting to share their project.
I see more the discussion about design and politics, so maybe we can go back to that at the end if we still have the time for that.
Okay, so I suggest that we let the floor to Jannicke, Hølen. who is from Design and Architecture Norway, DOGA. Yannick, you are a project manager in inclusive design. So it's a very interesting a topic for the new European Bauhaus, inclusive design. If you want to explain you what you are doing for innovation for all. The floor is yours, Yannick. If you could share your screen.
I'm trying to share my screen and I'm a little bad with technology and now I can't find my presentation, but let's try again here. Can you see this?
No. Not yet. If not, Sonia, it's okay.
It's okay, good, great.
You can see it. and this is a heartfelt input on the considerations and discussion through what true inclusion through design is all about. But first, a little backdrop. Design and Architecture Norway, also called DOGA for short, previously Norwegian Design Council. We promote design-driven innovation through various long-running programs. We are a government-funded national body for design-driven innovation, cross-ministry policies. We have a design-driven innovation program with tools and incentives for private businesses. And we have the Stimula program for solving wicked problems in the public sector through service and systemic design. And we have the longest running Innovation for All program on inclusive design as part of the Norwegian government's policies and action plan for a truly inclusive society. And in our Innovation for All program, we focus on competence building, knowledge sharing, best practice, handing out awards, and also a new design support financial program. And inclusive design is a very important strategy for business and public sector innovation because it secures the sustainability of a society by creating user-friendly solutions everybody can use and hopefully will use, leaving no one behind. And it is the design perspective of accessibility. And it's very important for equality and independence of the individual with significant ripple effects on business and society. And also called, as you may know, Universal Design and Design for All, it is a human-centered approach of design through the lens of diversity. And combined with high design competence and quality, the aim and also the proven results are improved user experiences for all with the benefits of innovation and high customer satisfaction for the business sector and a much smoother public services. And it's important to remind ourselves every day that every design decision has the potential to include or actually exclude people. There are so many new products, services, and systems introduced into the marketplace every day, and we love them. But still, there are so many of us who cannot use them because exclusion can, you know, be on the basis of, for example, age, technology level, disabilities, geography, economy, or social. It can also be on the basis of gender and cultural ethnicity, but let's make the focus on diversity go so much wider than that. And to develop new services and systems and environments, providing unique and intuitive user experiences for all, we need insights and aha moments from a wide group of real people. And any development process should have a vision of inclusion and user friendliness beyond minimum requirements, with the goal of launching new solutions people really love and can use. We, through our Innovation for All program, we hand out our government's Innovation Universal Design Award. And yes, we have a diversity also in the jury with people from disabilities organization, we have across business, we have across design and architecture. We honor user-friendly design solutions fit for a variety of people of high design quality and all being sustainable in a triple bottom line perspective. And here are six examples of previous winners I just want to go through with you. On the top left, we have the Vision of the Fjords, offering inclusive and sustainable tourism aboard electric cycling boats on UNESCO protected fjords of Nærøyfjord. Your grandmother, your friend in a wheelchair, or even yourself with a stroller can easily board and get to the top outside of the boat, or experience the nature just as well through large windows inside. And even the propeller is designed for less vibrations, making the silent sailing even more magical for the blind, listening to the sound of their surroundings. We have the new visual identity in the middle for the capital of Oslo. They have developed a unified and accessible visual identity, providing easy to understand and tested communication and visuals for the people living in the municipality. The former identity of Oslo consisted of 250 different logos and organizations communicated in various ways, creating more confusion than clarity. Their new internal design system is innovative and inclusive for those hundreds of people using it every day, regardless of their level of graphic design or technology. And in the design process for the new visual identity, they involved over 2,500 people, including disability organizations, and real feedback from blind and partially sighted, people with dementia, people with language barriers, every day, give feedback to improving the communication and the visual identity. On the top right, you can see this year's winner of the Innovation Award for Universal Design. It's a mobile payment and banking system called Vipps. It's loved in Norway by 3.8 million people, which is a lot in a small country. They're scoring very high on innovation and user-friendliness. And here, inclusive design is a strategic choice. It's part of their DNA. And inclusive design is also part of their innovation processes, their design processes, all of their development processes. And they work every day to eliminate frictions their customers experience. And they have really earned their multiple awards for most recommended Norwegian brand. And now they're going international. To the bottom left, you see a photo of Vindmøllebakken sustainable co-living, designed as a small village in the city of Stavanger. This housing concept is based on a gaining by sharing model where everyone owns less and share more, giving everyone a chance for a better economic, sustainable and social healthy lifestyle. People living here is a diverse combination of age, family size, ethnicities, disabilities and economies. In the middle, on the bottom, we also have the brand new Oslo Airport train designed by British Seymour Powell, where inclusive design is maxed in every aspect of services and solutions, driving the transport category onward. And if you visit Oslo, and you please have to come and see the Stone Tower, which allows everyone to get to the top to allow the spectacular view above the trees. And it's not the highest tower. It is the longest and the most considerate one for all ages and abilities. We have an online resource on inclusive design used well across the world in education and for those new to this approach. It is also a way for designers and architects to inspire their project owners. And we also have a book on innovating with people, can be downloaded. Or bought as a paperback. But we also welcome your projects in here. We would be happy to have more inclusive design and architecture projects showcased here. And why am I talking about inclusive design in a sustainability perspective? The sustainability, the goals everybody know is about creating regenerative solutions, fighting climate challenges, but they are just as much about collectively lifting up all people, contributing to equal opportunities for a good and independent life. And we need to rethink to adapt to the future. We have to remind ourselves that development mustn't take place at the expense of either the planet, the people, or even economic stability. So when starting up, during, and on completion of all projects, we all need to ask ourselves, to what extent will this solution be as sustainable as possible throughout its value chain and in a system with other solutions? And how, this is important, can it simplify and improve people's everyday lives throughout the user journey? And we all know that the world needs design in creating a better tomorrow. So just, we should agree on that sustainability is the ultimate design brief, and diversity and inclusion is the ultimate inspiration. Thank you.
Thank you, Yannick. Super. And this makes the link with the how last but not least speakers, Mark. So I'm happy to introduce you, Mark. Margarit Ravel, you are founder of a Bulgarian design group.
Yes.
We are happy to welcome you because it's not often that we have people coming from Bulgaria. So I hope that this event will be the opportunity to create a lot of collaboration with you. So the floor is yours. Please present us your project and some example. I know that you are working also on inclusive project.
Thank you, Isabel, for inviting me. Do you guys can hear me? Is everything okay? Great. So I'll continue Jannicke's topic for inclusive design, and we'll briefly walk you through something that I've been working for the past 5 years, and it's alive now. But first, a little background of me. I'm a designer from Bulgaria. I specialize in brand identities and graphic design, but also I've graduated as an engineer designer, so I'm building real stuff. Back in the days, like 14 years ago, I started something unofficially called the Bulgarian Design Group. Facebook was just starting then, and I've tried to unite all the young designers in the country in a place where it's inclusive, everybody's welcomed, and we could support each other, not just to like criticize and show our ego. So I've been developing this organization since then, and 8 years ago we started monthly events. We have a design mentorship program, we have a pro bono design module, we have a lot of sub projects. And I'm saying this just to give you a context that I've been trying to develop the local design scene in multiple ways. But at some point, I've tried to match this effort with my personal life, with my interests, with my kids, and try to develop a product which could help develop designers way earlier, not just on the phase when people need to decide what type of job they need, what are their best skills, and so on. So I stepped back and decided to create a game. So this talk, brief talk, is about a game. I'm going to share my my screen now. If that's, yeah, let's see if that works. Do you guys could see my screen? Okay, perfect. So the project is called Gamgee, and it's a game system to unlock everybody's creative potential. And now I'm gonna explain why it's inclusive and why it's something that, as far as I know, and I've been researching for the past 5 years, I haven't found anything like it. I'm gonna play this short video. Let me know if you can hear the sound. Yeah. So this is the thing that me and my team have been developing, and it's alive now. We've done a successful Kickstarter campaign, and we are already in the process of delivering the first batch to our backers. You've managed to see all the lines and the titles there, but think of it as like some 70 magnetic tiles instead of 52 cards. So this is the, let me close this one. Yeah, so this is the game system that you know from the past, and this is the new system that we are creating. These are 70 magnetic chips. They're two-sided, and they have special texture that allows also visually impaired people to touch the tiles and to understand what is written on them, side A, side B. There are three main pillars that that make this game inclusive for many people, especially for the visually impaired. The first one is the tactility. The second one is the magnetic grid, because there is a special system in each one of these tiny, tiny chips, because these are only 3 millimeters thick. So there's a special system. So when you touch these tiles with your closed eyes, you cannot scramble them, and you could play. And then the third one, the third pillar, is the special clicking sound, the clicking indicator. So combining these, we've created something that could be played in multiple places by everyone. Betting on a like universal design language that you already know being designers, but it's not that prominent for the general audience, we've actually created a design system that could be developed further by kids from different countries, you know, from South Africa, Netherlands, France, Bulgaria, Spain, whatever. And everybody could create a new game and share it in on the platform, on the website, which is gamgee.com. And, currently there are 30 games that we've developed that are solo games, from solo games to party games with 20 people, from games that are memory games to help kids, to games that are more towards learning programming and web development and teaching fundamentals, so that these youngsters could, or even grown-up people, could get to know better with this technology and the principles behind coding. So it's also a STEAM tool for education purposes. And there are so many things that I could tell you about. This has been a quite fun adventure for the past 5 years. I'm self-funding this because I'm an owner of a design studio. So I've dedicated some of my personal money to develop this. Currently, we haven't used any European grant or anything, but we are about to start participating in programs. Currently, we've been only to a couple of expos. The biggest one is in Germany. Maybe some of you who are playing board games know Spiel in Essen, where we've received amazing feedback from both from game designers and general designers and other people in the industry. So things are progressing, and this is something that is from this part of the world. I hope you enjoyed it, and if you like to spend time with with your friends and families, not in front of the screen, maybe you can give it a try. It's before finishing the talk, I would like to say that it's inclusive in another level as well, because very often there are not that many games that are for that broad audience, for small kids and for grown-up people like us. And everything you can put in your pocket, and then no matter who's on the table next to you and in your room, you can actually involve them in something fun, in a conversation, and you can even start prototyping with these tiles and create your design wireframe or basic 3D structure. So I hope that we'll turn this into a design tool as well. Thank you. If you have any questions, I'll stop my screen now, which is, let me see from where.
Okay, thank you, Mark. Thank you for sharing your experience on this topic, and Jannicke also. It's very important to work on inclusive design and inclusion. As we said, it's one of the three key attributes of the new European Bauhaus, but also of our project. Mark, if you would stop share, thank you. We have only 2 minutes now. Maybe I will let the floor to Paivi. If you want to conclude this third session before introducing the second session, I just said that to continue the discussion on all this topic, we will have the Wonder Room, and at the end of this second session, we will have a demonstration in order to help you to come with us in the Wonder Room if you want to have lunch and discussion with us. Paivi.
Thank you, Isabel, and thank you to everyone. Great presentations and very thought-provoking. And I'm happy that there has been so much discussion around the presentations as well and the approaches. What I would perhaps like to say as conclusion, also bearing in mind that we will continue the discussion in the session two, which will start at sharply at 11. Central European time. I always have to pay attention. I'm in the Finnish time zone, so the 1 hour difference, but 11 Central European time. And the reason I say this is that a lot has been discussed in this session, which also carries on to the session two, when we start talking about how design can help in transformation in local administrative levels. And this bears to my mind what Jannicke, how you described your approach in Norway. You put together inclusion and environmental sustainability or climate change mitigation. And that is exactly what the big picture is about. This we will continue in the second session as well. What it would be great to hear more, maybe you can contribute to that in the following session, is how in practical terms do you make sure that this systemic challenge of solving both inclusion and climate change mitigation, sustainability, happens in a systemic level. So maybe we can continue from that. But as I said, thank you very much. And hopefully, Kat, you can also be with us in the second session. I'm sure we will come back to the systemic design framework you have presented, and of course everyone else, also everything related to education involving young people and big idea and other issues that are other topics that have already come up here. Excellent input for all of you. Isabel, do you want to say something sort of technical information or not really leaving the room, but etc.
Yes, just technical. We have 15 minutes break. And if you could come back at 10:45 to have the welcome of our mayor before the second session at 11. So to hear our mayor saying welcome to all of us, please join us at 10:45. And before then, have a good coffee and see you later. Thank you.
Yes, and just I have to add, for those who follow us live on YouTube, please stay connected on our website, on our